Thank you. Security is scary, right? It's a big, complex, kind of overwhelming subject. There's a lot of things around it, and the ramifications are a little scary, you know, if you do things wrong. And just when you think that you might be figuring it out, you're like, well, strong passwords are important, and there are these SSL certificates. I think I maybe have got this figured out. Something like XSS or SQLi sneaks up on you and just freaks you out, right? And before you can even figure out what's going on, you're like, I can't handle this. Get me out. I want out of this. But it doesn't have to be scary. This is Aragon. Aragon is a family pet that we had for 10 years. Unfortunately, between the time that I wrote this talk and gave this talk, she has passed away. But she is not scary at all, contrary to what that poor cat thought about the bearded dragons that it encountered. She is extremely docile. She's kind of cuddly, honestly, even though she may not look it. And she's also vegetarian, by the way, so that cat had really nothing to worry about at all. But that cat thought that it was facing Godzilla, and I think that a lot of us feel that way when we're thinking about security, just because it seems so big and seems so overwhelming. But it really can break down pretty easily into some things that we can do, a mindset that we can sort of have to brave our way through it. Now, to be fair, when I first met Aragon, she was not an 18-inch long lizard that like the ones that terrified that cat. She was about 3 inches long and sat on the palm of my hand, and, you know, she grew up. But that was how I first experienced her, and that's kind of how I want to start you guys with security, is to kind of start at the beginning, at the smaller stuff, and as we push through, sort of show you how you can use a specific mindset to take these simple, easy things and slowly expand on them over time to increase your security online. And I am going to have a few specific WordPress things, but a lot of this is going to be really general, across the board, help you keep yourself more secure on the internet. This means that what I'm not going to do is run through all the various types of attacks. This is the kind of stuff that feels so overwhelming, right? If I were to stand up here and just start listing through all the various types of potential compromises, potential vectors of attack, I could spend my whole 30 minutes up here just running through a quick synopsis of each. We wouldn't even be able to dig into them all. We wouldn't get to go through fixes. And that's where everyone first starts doing something like Googling, you know, how to keep my site secure, and then they freak out like that poor cat because it's just too much. So we're going to look at ways to drastically improve your security by putting in a little added effort. There will be some effort required. I promise it will not be too difficult, but you do need to be willing to put in some effort. And by making some smart decisions along the way. And we're going to look at some of the places that we need to make those decisions. Hopefully, a few that you didn't even realize. You sort of skipped right past the security check at these various points. And hopefully help you identify those areas where taking a little extra time and thinking through things to make a decision that considers the security of your site will really help you out. So when everyone thinks about securing your website, what's the first thing that you think about? Several people said passwords, and it's the first thing that we think about in general. Most people, you all came in here already knowing passwords are important for security. But it's not where you start with security, actually. It's when you're getting ready to make a site and you want that site to be secure, Password's not the place that you start. So in order to try to give you kind of an example to picture, I want you to picture your website as though it was a house. You want to live in a secure house. You don't want people breaking into your house. So what do you do? Well, passwords are like locks on the door. They're important. They really are. But before you run out and buy the latest, greatest deadbolt, if you really want a secure home, maybe you start by choosing a good neighborhood to build that home in or to buy that home in. And for your website, that is the exact same thing. That is choosing a quality host. How many people here considered security when they chose their host? Asked their host, what do you do to keep me secure? Or researched what their host does to keep them secure? That was not nearly enough of you. So who has a website, so that I know? Yeah, basically everyone has a website, but only a fraction of you considered security when you chose where to put that website. And I'm not going to stand up here and go through all the hosts and say, you know, secure, not secure. That's not the point of this. But this is one of those places where if you want your site to be secure, you need to check your host and see if you've made a good decision for putting your site in this place. And it's totally reasonable to ask them, hey, what do you do to keep my site secure? That's not an unacceptable question to ask. The great thing is, for this weekend, there's been several hosts out here, actually. And you've had the chance to talk to them, and there will still be a little time to talk to them even after this session is over. And so if you're curious, ask. Find out, what do you do to keep my site secure? Because otherwise, your site is built on this foundation that could not be secure in and of itself. So this is one of the first places to make some good decisions before you ever even get to the site. But even now, with your site, is something that anyone that didn't raise their hand, you should talk to your host. You should find out what they do and if they're keeping up sort of their end of the deal. Otherwise, you have to be responsible for the security of the network and the server, including its operating system and the web server software, Nginx or Apache, and PHP and MySQL. And do you want to do that? Or pick a host that does that for you so that you don't have to worry about it. Most people would rather pick a host to do that for them. The next place to make a good quality decision is by choosing quality software. Now, I am admittedly biased, but I think that most of you have probably already made at least one good choice here by choosing WordPress. I lead the WordPress core security team, which is probably why I'm biased about this, but we have a large group of people that work very actively to make sure that WordPress is as secure as we can possibly make it. I think that that's a great choice. WordPress is probably not the only software that you are using. So while that's a great start, did you consider security when you chose your plugins or themes? Just like I asked if you talked to your host about security, did you talk to plugin developers? Did you check to see what kinds of things they do around security? Don't ask, have you ever had a security issue? Because they probably have, and that's not bad. The real question is, how do they handle it? How do you stay secure while using their product? Are they good at getting fixes out quickly? Are they good at alerting you and letting you know that you need to update? Those kinds of things. But I also want to take this time to talk about that security mindset that I want everybody to try to slowly work into. I had a friend that hosted several sites, ran several sites. This was several years back. And all his sites got hacked. And after a little while, he of being frustrated because he couldn't get it all fixed, it kept coming back. He came to me to see if I could help him out. And when we tracked it all down, we found out that his sites were getting hacked because of his image editing software. Yeah, that sounds strange, but...
image editing software you mean like Photoshop or something?
Yes, Photoshop. And let me explain why. The reason why was because he was using, in his particular case, shall we call it questionably legal software. He had downloaded a free version that he had found somewhere. And in this case, what that software came with no extra charge was this fantastic malicious code that monitored all FTP traffic in and out of his computer, even hooked into FTP, popular FTP programs of the time, and sent his username, password, the host that he was connecting to, and his IP address to someone else who then used that to log into his servers and do all sorts of really frustrating things. But all the traffic looked completely legitimate because they never even got the password wrong, because they just, he might as well have just written it down and handed it to them. Now, this is obviously a bit of an extreme case. Hopefully no one here is using software like that. But the truth is, it's not just the software on your site. It's not just WordPress and your plugins and your theme that can affect the security of your site. The things that are on your computer that you use to connect to that site, possibly the coffee house Wi-Fi that you connect through and who else is on that at the time. These are all things that can affect the security of your site that you don't always think about. And so we're going to look at some ways of protecting against that as we go through this. But this is one of those times I want you to stop and go, oh, there are things that could affect my site's security that I didn't even realize affected my site at all. Because that's kind of the first step to slowly diving into that security mindset that I want us all to get in. Which brings us to one of the easy things to lighten the topic back up, which is passwords. Right? Everybody here, when you got here, you all knew that you needed good passwords. But what makes a good password? That is one of the things. Changing it is important, and we will get to that. There are three basic things that actually make a password good. It needs to be long, it needs to be random, and it needs to be unique. Long, random, and unique. A good password is long, random, and unique. Long, how long? Well, in order to not scare too many people off, I tend to say at least 20 characters. In reality, all of my passwords are 50 plus characters. Give me a second. 50 characters, yes. Random, not a phrase that most people won't know, not I chose this poem because it's something important to me, not it's a mixture of my dog's names and my kids' names and my birth date and several other things, completely randomly generated. The best passwords are completely randomly generated. And unique means you only ever use them in one place. The password to get onto my website is different than the password to get onto my computer, which is different than the password for my email, which is different than the password for my bank. You see where I'm going? Every password's different. So, how is that possible? How can I possibly have 50 character passwords that are completely random, meaning that my, you know, average memory capacity is not able to even remember one of them? How could I have that and then have them unique everywhere? There's only one way, and it's a password manager. Who here uses a password manager? Perfect. So all of those of you that had your hand down still, find one of those people that had their hand up and ask them about their password manager and how they use it and how you can too. Because the only possible way to have good password practices online is to use a password manager. There is no other way that you could possibly have all those passwords. This is, there you go. I have a nice long password for that. It's the only one I have to remember, and I do change it very regularly, but it's difficult. But that at least it brings it down to just one, but keeps you secure everywhere. So, On the password manager, this is one of those places where it takes a little added effort. I said that everybody was going to have to put in a little effort if you wanted to be secure. This is one of those times. It takes a little effort, especially at the beginning, to get a password manager set up and get in the habit of using it. It feels a little awkward at first. Just a second. It feels a little awkward at first, and it takes a little getting used to. But with the password manager, the great thing is once you do get used to it, it really doesn't add any additional effort or time to your workflow. Once you've got it set up and taken the time to get used to it, it will make your life easier, not harder, which is pretty fantastic. There was a question in the back.
How often do you change your password?
We will get to that in a few slides. I personally use LastPass as a password manager. A lot of people use 1Password, especially the people that have bought heavily into the Apple ecosphere. I guess that it fits that better. I don't care what password manager you use, but you need to use one. And when we get to the end of the slides, the link to the slides will be there again, and all of these purple words are links that will take you to help you find these things, these tools that you need along the way. But the even really great passwords all have one sort of fatal flaw, which was pointed out just a minute ago, which is that we don't change them very often, right? And even if your password is super long, no one's ever gonna guess it, and it would take years to brute force that. How secure is, you know, the coffee house Wi-Fi that you connected through, or the Wi-Fi here? How do you know who's listening in or not listening in? If somebody does get your password, is that useful to them for 3 months, 6, a year? Who has no passwords, not a single one, that are older than a year? Like every one of your passwords has been changed within the last year. 1, 2 people out of an entire room. You see, that means that if somebody does get your password, they can do things possibly without you even knowing it for a year at least. That's a little scary, right? So how can we take passwords to the next level without changing them every day? We can use 2-factor authentication. Now, 2-factor authentication is actually a form of multi-factor authentication. Multi-factor authentication says that there are a few ways that you can verify that you are who you claim to be. When you go to log into your website, you throw in your username, you're like, I am Aaron, and the site says, prove it. And you say, I can prove it to you because I know my password. That is one method of proving that you are who you are. That is something that you know. That's one factor. Other potential factors are something that you have, like your phone, or in the physical world, maybe an ID card, you know, the card to get into your hotel room. These are things saying, if I have this, then I must be me. And then the last possible type of authentication is something that you are, like a fingerprint or an iris scan, right? Those are you. 2-factor authentication just says that in order to verify that I am who I say I am, I want at least 2 of these things. On the internet, that's almost always something that you know, which is your password, and something that you have, which is usually your smartphone. Who here has a smartphone? Yeah. Who here uses 2-factor authentication? Yeah. So those of you that raised your phone at the beginning and not the second question, you have the tool right there with you. Adding 2-factor authentication to WordPress itself is very easy. There are 2 plugins that I recommend that can do it. The first is iTheme Security Pro, which is admittedly a paid plugin, but it does a lot of other great security things as well. And there's also a simple plugin called 2-factor by a guy named George Stefanis that will add 2-factor authentication to your site. And then install any of these apps on your phone. I like Authy because I think it is easier to use. And every time that you log into your site, you give it a username and password, and it says, now prove that you have your phone by entering a code. You open the app on your phone, it gives you a 6-digit code, and you type that in. That 6-digit code regenerates every 30 seconds. It's a time-based algorithm that's used to generate these. And every 30 seconds, that code changes, which means that this is kind of like changing your password every 30 seconds. if a person steals your password and your two-factor token, it's still only good for 30 seconds. Then your phone generates a new one, and it's no good anymore. They need your phone to see the new one. This is another one of those places that it takes some added effort. Unfortunately, it's not just to set up. Every time you log into your site forever, it will take you an extra, 15 to 30 seconds to log in, because you have to open that app and type in 6 additional digits. The amount that this increases the security of your user account is massive. It's honestly kind of hard to quantify how much this increases it. So it is well worth the effort. And then you'll find that once you get used to doing this for your WordPress site, you can add this in lots of places. It's likely that that your Amazon account supports it and your Gmail account supports it. I checked yesterday on my phone, I have like 50 places that I use two-factor authentication for, because it makes me that much more secure everywhere. I already have the app installed. I should do that.
And you do this every time you log into a WordPress site?
So, yes. I mean, yeah, absolutely. Without a doubt. And it's because it makes it so much more secure that I am more than happy to spend that extra 15 to 30 seconds to do that. Yeah.
If I'm setting up that two-form factor, it's going to, do I have to put my cell phone number in all those sites?
For the other users? So it doesn't use your cell phone account. It just uses an app on your phone. It'll generate a 2D barcode, and you'll point the app at the computer screen. It will sync the app to the site, and it will use that app. It does not text you those codes. It just generates them in the app. So that brings us to another thing that helps with this worrisome thing that I pointed out of public Wi-Fi, which is SSL, which somebody pointed out right at the beginning. SSL is a security certificate for your site. That was easy for me to say. And what it does, like its job, is to encrypt everything between the website and the computer accessing it, which is fantastic, because now all that traffic going through the coffee house Wi-Fi is encrypted traffic. Far more difficult for anyone to mess with. Certainly not something that they can just grab and instantly know your password. So this is extremely useful. And at this point, there's really no reason that any site should not have SSL. Many places are starting to offer it for free. The ones that still charge, it's really inexpensive, whereas, say, 5 years ago, it may have cost you $1,000 a year to get a certificate. Now, it's extremely inexpensive. They're really, no matter whether you're processing credit cards or not, there really isn't a reason not to have SSL on your site. There's no reason that anyone between your user and your server should really be able to see what's being sent back and forth. And an SSL certificate prevents that. These are so easy to get and set up. Much of the time, you can just do it through your cPanel or whatever it is that you use to manage. If not, opening a ticket with your hosting company, and they can install it for you. Yeah, there's another question. Yeah, a lot of them are offering free SSL. Some still charge. It's inexpensive, usually. Many of them offer it for free, and a lot of times you can set it all up yourself. There's usually options in your control panel to turn that on. And so it's at this point that I get a lot of people asking me, why? Why all the worry about security? Why would anybody try to break into my site? I don't process credit cards. I don't have a bunch of people's identities to steal. Why would anybody even attempt to break into my site? I love this quote from Gerald Barron, ex-coworker of mine. It's not if you get attacked, but rather how you prevent it from being successful. Because there are two basic types of attacks on the internet. There are those focused, targeted attacks that everybody thinks about when we talk about, you know, hacking into sites. And those are actually a very tiny percentage of the overall attacks that happen on the internet. The far more prevalent ones are scripted attacks. Someone has written a program that crawls the internet looking for sites with weak passwords or out-of-date software or that are on some sort of insecure platform. Anything that it knows how to break into, especially out-of-date software, and then it breaks in and upload some sort of small payload. Right now, probably the most popular thing is pharmacy ads, because those are actually really profitable. And instead of making, you know, thousands or hundreds of thousands of dollars after some long targeted attack, they make a few dollars off of every site, but they just indiscriminately attack hundreds of thousands of sites and successfully get into thousands, and they don't care who it is or how much traffic it gets or what's on it, because they're just uploading ads. So it's not a question of if, it's a question of when. If you have something connected to the internet, someone will, or some automated bot will, eventually try to break into it. So we want to make it hard on them. And the things that I just went through are the things that we need to do to make it hard on them. And that starts at the very beginning by choosing a good host, right? Some of you need to go talk to your host. You don't know that you're on a bad host, but it's worth talking to them about security, or at least researching what they do to keep you secure. Are they keeping the software that's running your site up to date? Are they patching it with security patches? Are they watching network traffic and blocking bad behaviors? What are they doing for you?
Is there any reputational service that links sites? Because you said talk to your host to see what they do, and you also began with a talk saying how scary it is. So if we get a bunch of blue hills or site around or go down people spouting out all the security things, how is the average person supposed to say that's a quality host?
That's a good question, and probably a longer one that I should get into after I finish the presentation up, but I'll try to give some basic things that that you might want to hear from a host that will let you know that they're doing the kinds of things that they ought to be doing. So the next thing is choosing good software, which I think that WordPress is a fantastic start, but taking the time to think about things like your plugins and your themes and whatever else that you're using to interact with and work with your site. Are you using some strange, abnormal FTP client to push files up? Like, all these things that potentially touch your site are potential risks. And have you looked at them like that? Or have you just grabbed them because it was the first thing that you saw and you didn't really think about how that could affect the security of your site? And then we're going to get a password manager. The people that didn't have their hands up for that, find somebody that does, or at least go through, grab my slides and go click through and get yourself a password manager set up. It's the only way to have good password practices, because passwords that are long, random, and unique are not going to be something that you can manage on your own. Two-factor authentication, which is to take our passwords to the next level. This is one of those things that will always add a little bit of added effort, but also adds a massive amount of additional security. SSL certificates on all your sites. And the great thing about this is if you do these things, which are in fact something that you can do, these are things that are manageable by everyone here, you're going to cover yourself against those scary attacks, that short list that I showed, and even the much longer list that exists, without having to be overwhelmed by what they all are, how they all function, you can take this list of things and do this and increase your security with just that. And so this is me. I'm Aaron Campbell. As he said, I work for GoDaddy. I work full-time on WordPress. I run the WordPress core security team. And this is the URL that I promised to my slides. You can go there and check them out. They are all on my site and running on WordPress. And that's it. Does anybody have any questions? I guess we already had one that I should get to before I forget, because I will forget. And that was on, if you ask a host about security practices, how do you know that they're not just spouting rhetoric as opposed to actually telling you what you actually need to know? Some things that you can listen for are how they handle keeping all of their software stack patched for security. Are they always pushing you to the latest release of PHP? Maybe, maybe not. If they do, that's fine. You're always going to be secure. If they don't, are they at least patching every version of PHP that you're on? Like, these are things that you don't want to have to worry about, but they need to be done, so your host should be doing them. They should be keeping that whole stack patched for security. Do they have network-level systems in place to watch for bad traffic across their whole network? This is a benefit that hosts have that no single website can have. No matter how many security plugins you may try to put on your WordPress site, you can never identify a bad behavior until they have come to your website, whereas a host that may have thousands or hundreds of thousands or even millions of sites, they have the ability to watch at a much higher level and see and block people, maybe because they hit somebody else's site before they ever even got to yours. And that's amazing, but are they doing that? Like, is your host doing that? These are the kinds of things that you want to hear from them. And honestly, one of the biggest signs is when you ask this question, if they just know the answer, that's right. Like, if they are unsure what they do to keep your site secure, that's a red flag. Any other questions? Yeah, right here.
I was told to change the login page from whatever website / /w-admin. That's just one more opinion about it.
So
how important is that?
Well, I would say it's not important at all. There was a time when it probably was. There was a time when it definitely was. Let me put it that way. Because, let me start by saying WordPress is very large in the market, and so we have a giant target on our back, right? Because if somebody wants to compromise lots of sites, then if they can find a way of compromising WordPress, that's a big percentage of the sites out there. If they can find a way of sort of targeting WordPress sites, well, probably one in every four sites that they hit is going to be a WordPress site. That's good for them. So the scripted attacks that crawl the internet, while they're not 100% focused on WordPress, they definitely have WordPress-specific attacks that they try to use, looking for, say, /wp-login.php. It used to be that they looked for that, and then if it wasn't there, they went, oh, must not be a WordPress site, move on. They have gotten smarter since then. So they've gotten much, much smarter since then. If you can find your login page, they can too. So it's better to secure your site with strong password, two-factor authentication, SSL, than it is to try to hide it from them. That's kind of like hiding a key somewhere on your front porch, but then telling somebody, there's a key on my front porch, but you'll never find it.
Yeah.
They're probably going to find it.
So what are salts then? Somebody said, like, I don't know, I got some warning about salts on the plugin or
okay, so
salts is.
Okay. Salts are another thing that are actually really important, but probably not to you. And here's why. Passwords should never be stored in their plain text anywhere, obviously. They also should not be able to be reverse engineered. If somebody were to get into your WordPress database somehow and download all of it, they'll have this long, weird string of characters that represents your password in some way, but there's no way to reverse engineer that back into your password. The reason is because the way those are encrypted is a hashing algorithm, which is one-way encryption. It can be encrypted, but not unencrypted. And then when you type in your password, that hashing algorithm is run again and compared against that to say, oh, this was the right password. But you can never go the other way. Notice that you can't say, recover my password from WordPress, but you can say, reset it, because it can't undo that thing, which is good. And salts are a part of that process that make sure that if I use the same password on my site and your site, which I would never do, but if I did, the string in your database and in my database would be different because the salts were different. So even though WordPress is using the same algorithm, it's using a different salt for every site, and so those end up different, which means that even if someone were to compromise many WordPress sites, they wouldn't be able to come up with any simple way of reverse engineering those passwords. So salts are important. There was a time when if you were compromised and your, say, site was thoroughly hacked and you were, you know, they had access to your server, that you would want to change those salts because it was possible for the attacker to know that. We have since done some major changes in WordPress, so if you're on one of the latest, I think it's been 4 or 5 versions since we did that. Things were drastically different. You'll notice that there's stuff in the admin section in your profile that lets you see if you're logged in from multiple locations and kick yourself off. Like, say, if you didn't log out from home, you could actually kick yourself off from work when you're logged in. That is all part of this new system that sort of makes changing your salts unnecessary anymore. Salts themselves are necessary. You knowing about them and changing them is not.
So I have 2 questions. One is, does GoDaddy block or hide your HTTPS file? No, HD access file.
HD access file?
And your config sys file.
So, first of all, let me preface this by saying that I don't actually work on any GoDaddy products. I am 100% working on WordPress. Having said that, I've used their hosting, and yes, HD access files are not publicly accessible because they're meant to contain data that's only meant for the server and not meant for users. There's no reason to make that available.
Right. So my other
question, 2 questions. It's all good.
My other question is, concerning passwords, what are your feelings about
Saving your password in your browser and being able to move it to another browser?
Yes.
I don't use either of those. I use LastPass because that's where I lock up all my passwords. Instead of having the browser remember my password, let me see if it's visible on this really low resolution screen or not. I have this, which is a browser add-on. LastPass has a browser add-on. 1Password does too. Oops, I don't know where I went to. but they both have browser add-ons that, my slide is gone. It's all right. They both have browser add-ons that add that functionality to any browser you want to use. And that includes Firefox, Chrome, your browser on your phone, and Safari, if you use that, wherever you are, your passwords can be there too. Yeah?
One fear that has kept me from using a password manager like LastPass is a single point of failure. If that password gets compromised or if that service goes down, I don't have access to anything.
Well, so that's not totally true, but it is worth looking at. But the main, this is maybe one of the good reasons to use one of the two really big options out there. They both have been very open about how all this works, and it's been better for people to feel secure using it. The way LastPass works, while they do have encrypted versions of your passwords in an area so that it can download to all these places, my browser is currently holding a set of that. So just if their service was down, it doesn't mean that I couldn't get to it. There's a copy of it on my phone right now as well, because I have the app for being able to access it there. And their algorithms that they use for doing that are particularly good, far above industry standards, which is fantastic. Yeah.
We all have users on our website. We have a security mindset. Would you be comfortable with users having the names of the dogs and their children if they only have limited roles and just secure the admin?
So the question is about users, and they're not all going to be as security conscious as you, but there's likely other users on your sites. What do you do about that? There are several things that you can do. The first is only give them as much access as they need. That's always a best practice. If they can, having said that, if they can, you know, edit and modify posts and publish them, like, there's quite a bit of risk involved there. You, first of all, educating your users is the first step. Educating people is really hard, though. Let's be honest. Additional things that you can do if they must have access that could potentially hurt or affect your site is force them to have good passwords and such, which can be done with a plugin like the iTheme security one that I linked to. It can enforce strong passwords or even expiring ones so that you can make them change their password every 6 months or whatever. But there's always the balance, right, between ease of use and secure. And unfortunately, it's hard to answer that question because that's going to be different for everybody depending on your site and the risk involved, the people that you're dealing with. But those are the two things that you're balancing: ease of use and risk at being broken into. And you're going to have to figure out where that balance is and decide, do I need to force them to be more secure or take away some of their access, or where is that balance at? Yes?
Yeah, this goes back to your friend with Photoshop.
I don't know that there is.
Yeah.
So for FTP, though, something that you could look into if you're really scared of that, first of all, use SFTP, not FTP, because that's the SSL encrypted version of that. And then the next thing that you could do is, and I sort of worry about saying this because it's kind of taking us to a whole other level on the security talk, but you could talk to your host about SSH keys, which are far more secure than a password. It's like a whole encryption key. There's a public version and a private version, and you can generate that and put one part of it on your server and one part of it on your computer, and it will use that to authenticate instead of a password, and that would take FTP or SFTP kind of to that next level. You could see if your host supports that. It might be. Yep. Yes.
In the IP security plugin, we can see who's attacking through the IP address. Are they using botnets or something else?
So, are the people attacking using botnets? Yeah. So that's one of the difficult things. That's still, security is always a race between us and them a little bit, right? People trying to break into sites are constantly coming up with new and interesting attacks, and those of us that are trying to protect them are constantly trying to come up with new ways of blocking that. One of the common ways is tracking IP addresses, and one of the common ways around that is to get thousands and thousands of IP addresses, and instead of doing 1,000 attacks from this IP address, you do 2 from each of 500, and so it looks like 500 different people have only accessed the site twice. It's very difficult to block. So those IP, the things like iTheme Security that track based on IP, sometimes that works. Some attacks are coming from one central location. A lot of times, though, you're missing it because they're using botnets. Having said that, I also know that like iTheme Security does temporary bans and stuff, so this IP's currently behaving badly. Ignore it for a while, but then IP addresses don't permanently belong to one person. They could be leased out to another person minutes later, so it only blocks for a certain amount of time, then sort of reopens it up. So, I mean, they're doing their best at trying to use that as one of many tools, but yeah, it would be kind of ineffective all on its own because of botnets. Yes?
Could you make the distinction for us between security of the website versus security of the computer and any correlation between them?
Yeah, I guess. I mean, they use, believe it or not, your website and your computer use kind of similar security systems, but really the correlation between them is just if you use your computer to access your website, then if there's anything that's been compromised, I mean, who's gotten a virus on your computer before, right? Yeah, unfortunately, everybody makes horrible faces when they raise their hands. That's kind of hilarious from up here, sorry. But but yeah, the you know, those kinds of things, those viruses, they're being malicious. They're trying to do something to your computer. One of the common things that they do now that the internet is so popular is try to steal anything that you're sending back and forth to a website. So, you know, keeping good practices on your computer, keeping, you know, virus protection on it and that kind of stuff can help keep your site secure, because once your computer logs into that, like that's making a connection. That's a place where you can sort of infect one from the other. Yes?
One of the things I did for the WordPress websites that I built that helped tighten WordPress security just a little bit is I'll move WP config file one by one out of the public HTML directory. But the ID and password is still in clear text. Is there anything that you know that WordPress may be doing to keep that ID and password from being clear text?
You're talking about the database connection information. There really isn't anything that can be done to avoid that, but at the same time, that while it's in plain text, it's never visible to a user, even if it's in the directory, because your server should be serving it as PHP, and that's code. It's code. It's between those open and closing PHP tags. It's not something that a user could see. Even if they could directly access that file, they would see it as blank, because the server runs that file and says, this is part of this variable, and this string is part of this variable, and then it gets to the end and says, well, didn't need those variables for anything, blank file, and that's all you see if you try to access it directly. And I'm sorry, before I take another question, time-wise, like, when is... Okay, I knew that I'd taken a lot of questions. Okay, I want to answer as many as I can, but I also don't want to like keep you guys past
5 minutes. And then
okay.
Head on over to
perfect.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm in an organization called SCORE, where we entrepreneurs come in to start a business. We've got an entrepreneur wants to start a business. He's in the medical profession, wanting to build a WordPress app, but he's pretty well said, I'm not going to do it because I got to deal with HIPAA. Super secure stuff.
Uh-huh.
Would you use WordPress? Would you even consider using WordPress for this type of an application?
So I have built several different sites and systems that had to be HIPAA compliant that used WordPress before I worked at GoDaddy and before I worked, before I worked at GoDaddy, I ran my own company for quite a while and worked with some of those enterprise level clients that he was talking about. We ran projects like that. I actually think that WordPress is relatively simple to use and stay HIPAA compliant. The biggest struggle in HIPAA compliancy is hosting, because your hosting has to meet those HIPAA standards, and you usually have to turn in paperwork accordingly that's saying that I meet all these requirements. And even though several of those are actually requirements of your host, you're the one that's on the hook for signing and saying that. So being able to get good hosting that's HIPAA compliant is going to be important. Yes, and some of them are going to say that they're HIPAA compliant, and sometimes you just have to go through that list that HIPAA gives you, and it's got requirements, and you have to sort of look for those requirements at whatever host you're considering. But yeah, I would try to talk to the host. Most of them are pretty well aware of HIPAA and how it works, and maybe which of their product offerings meet that compliance and which ones may not.
Thank you.
Yeah. Short comeback to that. That's an interesting one. So WordPress has definitely gotten, had that reputation at various points along the way, mostly because we're a very big project, again with that target on our back that I was talking about, and people want to find something to pick on us about, and that is a thing that you can pick on us about that is scary to users, that might scare them away from WordPress and over to this other thing that you want, and is also very difficult and complex to understand. And so it's an easy way of sort of saying something without necessarily having to back it up. Not that WordPress hasn't had any security issues. It has, but compared to other similar products and platforms, it's actually performed extremely well. My general short answer, and we could probably try, I can try to find where I used to have this information, but putting together a list of big companies that do use WordPress, companies like Disney and the New York Times and these kinds of places that have all done security reviews on WordPress and approved it and said this is acceptable. I mean, our government uses it. Lots of big companies that can't actually use software unless it's undergone security reviews use it. And being able to have like a list of those companies and just say, well, it passed the security review for these. And so that is probably pretty secure. Anybody else?
There's solutions and plugins like WordFence that try to scan your files for malware and compare them against the version in the repository to compromise.
So scanning your files is a good thing to do, I think. WordFence does that. iTheme Security Pro does that. SiteLock, who's upstairs right now, they do that. SiteLock even will pull those files away and clean them and put them back cleaned and fixed if it finds it. That's a great way. So when a hacker breaks in, usually one of the first things they do is modify one of those files to put their payload in. And while that may not tell you exactly how they got in, it's a good warning sign, hey, there's a problem, we need to figure this out. And cleaning that up right away is very important. So monitoring those files for changes is extremely useful. Yeah, I do think SiteLock is a helpful add-on.
What do you suggest if we get hacked already and there's a couple of services that are getting too
so actually there's
oriented
There's a section in the WordPress codex that is titled something like "I've been hacked, what do I do now?" or something like that, that's got some good tips. There are several reputable companies in the WordPress ecosphere that clean stuff up. SiteLock's one of them, and Sucuri, which I was accidentally saying a minute ago, is another one. They're both very good at it. Yeah. I try not to represent just one of them because there are several good ones, so check into it.
So I'm guessing that in your choice of quality software, plugins, and themes, that another one would be the backup that you use?
Oh, yes.
For backups, that would be included in that group to see how well they handle security?
Backups I don't actually consider to be part of security, but I do consider them to be part of generally a good practice, because if something bad happens, being able to roll back to a previously functioning backup is super important. Having said that, security is not the only bad thing that can happen. But just generally speaking, backups are super important, but I don't know that I consider them specifically security related. It shouldn't be, because there shouldn't really be anything. It's no different than having your site stored on their servers already in order for people to get to your site. It's just also compressed and stored somewhere that probably no one except their employees have access to restore for you. So yeah, I wouldn't think it's an issue. I think that's it. I will still be around. So if you have more questions and I didn't get to it, just come find me.